this morning?
I do.
Well, come on up. Come on, kids.
Who did? Well, adults, how you doing today? I got two right here, don't I? I got another one. Come on down. Is he dusted up in that tie? Good gracious. Well, I thought I'd have quite a bit more today. What are these? Oh, there's some more coming. Kim's coming. No. Okay. Come on down. Yeah. Whoa. Oh, is Kathy coming? Yeah. Hey. Did y'all know y'all were wearing the same outfit? Did y'all know y'all look alike? Wow. Love those shoes. You think they're sisters? Are they twins? Oh my gosh. Awesome, awesome. That is just awesome. Wow. Well, come a little bit closer. Can y'all know what these are? Anybody know what these are? What? Absolutely. But what kind of tomatoes are these?
Red maters.
They're red maters. Now, what's different? Is that one different than this one?
Yeah.
Why? But one of them's bigger than the other. What about this one? Is this one different than these? Yeah. Well, like you're getting ahead of me, but you're getting, all right, so what about this one? Is this different?
Yeah.
What's different than this, than the red ones?
Oh,
huh? That one, what? Okay, well, wait a minute. Hold on now. That one's what?
Lello.
Lello. That's exactly right. This one's Lello, and this one's, yes, but we're going to pretend something. We're going to pretend that these are little bitty babies. Oh, little bitty, little bitty babies. Oh. And then they grow up, and they're like you. They're Lello. These are like you. See these? And then guess what happens? Then they grow up to be an adult. Ooh. Ooh. What?
And they turn back small.
No, they didn't turn back small unless somebody gives them a kick or so. But would you eat that? Why?
Because it's nasty.
So the little ones grow up, and as they turn big, now we remember we talked about these are babies, and these are you, and then they turn big as an adult. Guess what happens? Sin enters an adult's life, and it turns a person into being what?
A dog guy.
It makes a person feel like a dog's died. Smell like a dog has died. You stink of sin. And it's dirty, and this is what a person's life looks like, sin. Oh, would you like to examine this? Would you like your life looking like that? You what?
I hope it doesn't.
What about you?
No, I hope not.
What about you? Would you like your life looking like this?
No way.
Well, how do we get our life not looking like this? If it's full of sin and, ooh, crusty looking and sour looking and just, oh. You know what this person looks like all the time? This person probably goes around and doesn't like this and doesn't like that. Oh, I just, another spot came out. And then they don't like this. And they, well, I don't like this either. Did you see what that other person did? Oh, it's getting more spots. But that person heard about Jesus. And that person heard that Jesus, if you believe and you turn your, admit that you believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and you confess your sins. Yeah, and you believe. And guess what happens? Guess what happens?
He gets cleared.
He gets cleared? He does. He gets cleared. And this is what his life could look like with Jesus. Ooh. Look at that. Look at that. That's a tomato. But that's representing a cleaned life. Now, would you like your life like this? But what if I said you look like this? Anything you want to say about it? Nothing? You sure? The love of Christ makes it look like that? The blood of Christ? Did you say something right there? Huh? When Jesus died on the cross, He turned back into life, you first said, and good. And because of that, and we believe in Jesus and ask for Jesus to forgive our sins with no rotten tomato, it's all changed and now it's clean and we are clean and we can go out and tell others about Jesus. Woo-wee! I'd rather be a clean tomato, wouldn't you? Huh? I'd rather be a clean tomato than a dirty one. Well, come on down here and let's... You read my mind?
Yeah, we always pray.
Oh, gosh. Well, I hope you don't have a mind like mine. I'm telling you what, it'd drive you crazy. Okay, here we go. Oh, precious Father, thank you so much for your son dying on the cross so that we, when we ask him into our hearts, will have everlasting life. And Lord, sometimes our hearts can be like a dirty tomato, full of sin, full. And people can see us like that dirty tomato. But Lord, when we come and talk to you and we repent, we're like that clear, shiny tomato again. And I thank you. Let these children see the love and let them know loves them. In Jesus Christ we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Cynthia. Good morning. Good to see each of you this morning. Let me share a thank you note with you and some announcements. And then I want us to go into our business meeting this morning. We'd like to thank the church for the beautiful flowers, and this is from the Greg Smith family, so continue to remember that family. And in the way of announcements, remember tonight is the last Sunday night of Awesome August. That's hard to believe that these five Sundays have gone by this fast. It's been a great month. I've enjoyed it. I'm working with the other pastors right now, and hopefully we're going to be able to do something in the way of a community Thanksgiving service and also maybe a community Easter service between our five churches. So we're kind of working on that. Brother Ronnie will be preaching tonight. I want to ask you, when you come tonight, those of you that can, if you could just kind of park across the road over at the school, or park at the other end and kind of leave some parking spaces for our guests tonight. And then at the end of our service tonight, we're going to have a finger food dessert fellowship. I want to ask everybody to bring finger foods and desserts and bring a lot because there will be five churches. And again, be a good host tonight. Let our guests go first so they can at least try a little bit of everything before we get there and eat it all, okay? There'll be a WMU meeting at 5 o'clock, and there'll be no deacons meeting today because of the awesome August service and choir practice. Ladies' Day luncheon's coming up September the 12th. Sign-up sheet for that. If you need more information, you can talk to Patsy or Jan. Senior adult coming up on September the 5th to Hamrick. Sign-up sheet out for that. And we are having a Wednesday night supper this Wednesday night. And for a while, we're just going to do it the first Wednesday night of every month, okay? Kind of give Ed time to get back into the swing, see how this goes. You got a good meal this week. Hope everybody can come. And next Sunday morning begins the first Sunday of a brand new Sunday school year, the Sunday school. You'll be getting your new quarterlies if you've not already gotten them. Don't throw your old quarterlies away. We're going to give those back to the association so they can be reused by other churches, okay? Any other announcements this morning? Any other announcements? Any other announcements? Well, I want to call our church into a business session this morning. We've been announcing this now for about 6 or 7 Sundays. Going to have a called business meeting to vote on 3 things this morning. And these 3 things have been presented to the church. I do have some copies out. We did make a few changes, but they're just grammar. I type the way I talk, so we had to make some grammar changes. But we got 3 things we need to vote on, and I haven't had anybody ask me any questions about this, so hopefully this won't take this long this morning. If we see that it's going to take long and run into our service, then we will just reschedule this to a Wednesday night business meeting, okay? But our first order of business, and just let me refresh everybody's mind. We call this meeting, we made some changes in our constitution and bylaws. We made some changes in our building use guidelines. We're also voting to add Article 18 to our constitution and bylaws. From the Baptist faith and message. So first thing I want to do is ask the church to vote on the amendment to the Constitution and bylaws. Hope everybody's had time. We do not need a second because this comes from a standing committee. But basically we're just making some changes under qualifications to become a member of Highland Park Baptist Church. And this is under Section 1 qualifications. And there's already an A, B, C, and D, and we're adding an E. Hopefully everybody's had time to look at this, but it basically redefines what we believe marriage is according to God's Word. Anybody have any questions about adding this amendment, this modification to our Constitution and bylaws? If not, everybody that's in favor of adopting this amendment to our Constitution, would you please stand? Okay, thank you. You can be seated. And those that are opposed, would you stand? And Jan's the only one that voted against it. Oh, Jan was already standing up. The second thing that we're going to vote on is adding Article 18. In the amendment to the Constitution, we refer to the Baptist faith and message, Article 18, on the family. Our present Constitution has different articles about the Baptist faith and message, but it does not contain anything about the Article 18 on the family. So what we're doing is we're just adding Article 18 from the Baptist Faith and Message to our Constitution and Bylaws. Again, this coming from a standing committee does not need a second. So is there any discussion on this? All those in favor of adopting Article 18 to our Constitution, if you'd please stand. Okay, thank you. You can be seated. All those opposed? And again, that's by unanimous consent. I want to vote on these other two things together, if that's okay, if there's not any disagreement. Again, this comes out of the Supreme Court ruling, too, and felt like we needed to make some changes in the use of our building for weddings and also our fellowship hall. I hope everybody's taken the time to read this. The biggest change in this is, as of the vote today, only members of Highland Park Baptist Church will be allowed to use the church for a wedding. Have to be a member of the church. And that's defined as a mother, father, son, daughter, sister, brother, immediate family. And since we're just doing this just to church members, the deacons and the building and grounds got together and decided that there'd be no charge for a church member to use a wedding, a church for a wedding. I think the only charge is just like for the people that have to come to be here to run the sound and the custodian. And the other big change was that instead of going through Doris to use the church now, either for the sanctuary or the fellowship hall, you go through building and grounds, and the building and grounds gives the approval for that. Okay? And the same thing for the fellowship hall. The only difference in that is you have to be a member of the church to use the fellowship hall now. And it's sad that we have to get to a place like that, but to protect the church, we really have to do that. And somebody asked about outside groups using the church. We've got several community groups that use the church, and we still want to make that available to community groups, and that'll be still be up to the discretion of the building and grounds, just like anybody else using the building. And that's still a $50 charge to use it for a member. Anybody got any questions on this? Again, coming from standing committee, it does not need a second. All in favor of adopting our changes to our guidelines for building use, if you'd just stand one more time. Okay, thank you. You can be seated. And all those opposed? Well, thank you all. We need a motion now. Before we do this, one more thing before we adjourn this business meeting. I met with our deacons a few minutes ago. I've not been feeling good for about the last month or so. Ended up in the emergency room one night this week and went to the doctor, and I'm going to be having a heart cath. I can't remember the day, 9th, 10th, something like that. And doctor has recommended that I take some time away from the church. And the time that they recommended that I take away from the church was unsatisfactory to me. 2 months. And I said I'll compromise and do 2 weeks. So I've asked the church that after next Sunday, I do have baptism scheduled for next Sunday. I've asked the deacons if I could take 2 weeks off from the church to get the heart cath back and get that over with and see what happens, and kind of make the doctor happy and Bob Carroll happy. Okay. So after next Sunday, if I can get Gene to fill in for me for a couple of Sundays. I haven't talked to him yet, but I guess I need to talk to Carolyn, but Deacon said that'd be okay. Just continue to pray, and we'll pray for you, okay? Any other announcements this morning? Well, we need a motion that we adjourn our business meeting, but keep it open in case any other business comes up for our next scheduled business meeting. Have a second? All in favor say amen.
Amen.
Thank you all for the way that you conduct business as a church. It's a joy to have a business meeting when business meetings go like this. And I've been to business meetings where business meetings weren't a joy. Good to see each of you here this morning. Especially want to welcome our guests this morning. I want to ask our church family to stand for your guests. Just stay seated. We want to see who you are and where you are and come and welcome you this morning. Okay?
Thank you.
Let's all stand together and sing the old record.
My name is Ralph Berger. For those of you who do not know me, I'm the Deacon of the Week this week. My lovely wife, Sherry, she's not able to be here because Ava's probably not happy. But I've been blessed to be married to her 15 years next month. And what a blessing she's been to me in my life. And I just praise the Lord for her. I praise the Lord for my children this morning, for Emma, who's 10, and Ava, who's 3. Just what a blessing that they've been. I just want to praise God this morning, the only one worthy of praise. what he has done for us. You know, just praise the Lord. We've been studying in Revelations, this morning in Sunday school, we just talked about Revelations 21, new heaven and a new earth. That's what God has promised us. And the old devil's not going to be there, you know. We won't have to worry about that, here's the old devil again in my life, you know. Here's this old flesh dragging me down again, and I'm tired of it. So just praise the Lord, you know. He's the Alpha Omega, and he's the one in control of everything. Even the old devil has to ask him for permission. But I just want to say I'm proud to serve as a deacon. Just praise God for these men that I serve with. But it's not anything that I do, you know. Anything that I do that's any good is just praise to the Lord, you know, because he's in it. I can't do any good on my own, you know. But I just asked the church this morning, just pray for each other. You know, we need unity in our church. We need to get outside of these walls, and we need to proclaim the gospel. We need to share the hope that we have, you know. Tell them, hey, in Revelations, the devil's tied up, and we win. Do you want to be on our side, you know? If you're serving the devil today, you might want to change your mind, you know. But tell them the good news that we know, and just praise the Lord, and just pass that on. Don't keep it to ourselves, you know. Don't hide the lamp. But I felt there's a verse in the Bible that I felt encouraged to just say this morning. The old serpent, the devil, the dark side, whatever you want to call him, you know, he's come to kill, steal, and destroy. But I have come that you may have life and have it more abundantly. You know, who's I? Jesus, you know. Praise God. He's come that we may have life and may have it more abundantly. You know, John chapter 10:10. And so I just praise God for his word this morning. You know, that's one thing as Christians we ought to celebrate. We've got the word of God in front of us, and we ought to take time and study it and just pray to him and draw into that relationship with him, that we can get outside of these walls and spread his word, you know. Because, again, with all of us, it's only because what he does in us that we can do anything for him, you know, and give him glory. So just thank you for your time and attention this morning. Ushers, if you'll come this morning, we'll go ahead and take up our offering. Dear Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning, dear Lord, and we just adore you. We thank you for your power, your control, dear Lord. We just pray that you help us in our lives, dear Lord, to seek your face, Lord, that we may be a worthy vessel. But as we come before you this morning, dear Lord, and we receive an offering, we just thank you for the opportunity, dear Lord, because you blessed us so abundantly, that we may give back a portion, Lord, to that which is yours. I just pray that you be with us, dear Lord, as we remember you, the Lord's Supper, dear Heavenly Father. We remember what your Son did for us on the cross, dear Heavenly Father. Let us take that personal this morning and embed it in our hearts, that we may praise you for what you've done. And all these things we ask in your holy name. Amen. Thank you.
If you enjoyed that, you want to come early tonight, because after choir practice tonight, our worship band is going to be playing before the service tonight while everybody's coming in, and that'll be good. I've had people all month long, every Sunday night, somebody come up to me and say, "Preacher, I've really enjoyed Awesome August. I can't wait to get to Highland Park and hear the music." So, they won't be disappointed tonight, will they? Take your Bibles, turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 11, if you would. 1 Corinthians, this morning, we're observing the Lord's Supper together. And the Lord gave me a message about remembering. You know, it says in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 24, "And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'Take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you.' And then he said, 'This do in remembrance of me.'" And you can also go down verse number 25, talking about the cup. Verse 25 says, "After the same manner, he took the cup when he had supped, saying, 'This cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do you as often as you do it,' he said, 'in remembrance of me.'" You know, there are dozens of things, probably more than dozens of things, in my life that I've forgotten. And you can say that too. And I would tell you what some of those things are, but I can't remember them. But you know, the funny thing about a memory, I can remember things that happened 50 years ago, 30 years ago, just like it is yesterday. But at the same time, I can't even tell you what I had for dinner yesterday. And, you know, that's the way our memories get. But I say that to say this. There's one thing, folks, I could never forget, and we should never forget, and that's our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. In 1 Corinthians chapter 11, he says, "This you do in remembrance of me." And we, you know, Paul's teaching us about the Lord's Supper. And as he's teaching us about the Lord's Supper, he said, whenever you come together, whenever you take that bread, whenever you take that cup, whenever we gather around this table together, we do it in remembrance of Jesus. This do in remembrance of Jesus. And that brings to mind a question. Is it possible to forget Jesus? You say, "Oh, I could never forget Jesus." But folks, we sometimes live our Christian life and forget Jesus whom we follow. Amen. We sometimes come and worship and forget the one that we're here to worship. So it is possible to forget this Jesus that we say we could never, ever forget. And I know I've forgotten a lot of things. But folks, it's possible for us to at least forsake the one who is so important to us. So my sermon this morning, a sermonette, you might call it, because the Lord's Supper is a sermon in itself. But what I want to share with you for just a few minutes before we gather around the table together is really three questions about Jesus. First, how could you forget Jesus' life? And the second question is, how could you forget his death? Which leads us to the third question. How could you forget his sacrifice that he made for our sins? Think for just a minute about that first question. Can you forget the life of Jesus? Folks, when you think back about the life of Jesus from the time that he was born till he was crucified on the cross, how could you forget about his life? How could you forget about his birth? How could you forget about how he was born of the Virgin Mary? How he was conceived by the Holy Spirit? How could you forget that night that he was born, the angels coming to the shepherd that were watching over their flock out in the field. And when the angels suddenly appeared, they told the angels the good news. They said, a child's just been born. And it's a special child. It's a son that has been given. And he's going to be called Emmanuel, which means God is with us. Folks, how could we ever forget that? And how could you forget his baptism? Next Sunday morning, we're going to step into the baptism of waters with Kevin. How could you forget the baptism of Jesus when he walked into the waters of the Jordan River and there's this voice come booming out from heaven and said, "This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased." How could we ever forget that? Or could we forget his wilderness temptations? Do you remember when Jesus went out into the wilderness and he was so hungry because he hadn't eaten anything? And do you remember temptation after temptation came his way? But folks, he put Satan to shame. Do you remember that? Or how could you forget the miracles he performed in his life? How could you forget how he gave sight to the blind, or how he healed those that had leprosy, or he caused those that were lame to walk again, or that were deaf to hear again, or how he walked on the water, or how he took a little bitty boy's lunch and he turned it into a feast, and even had a little bit left over after he fed a multitude of people? How could you forget, folks, the life that he lived? And he lived it for you and me. Paul says in 1 Corinthians this morning, as we take that bread in our hand and as we take that cup in his hand, we're to remember his life and all that he did for us in his life. But the second question I want to ask is, how could you forget his death? You know, you think about his life, but at the end of his life, his friends abandoned him. His enemies came and grabbed hold of him. And his life was getting ready to come to an earthly close. The crowds began to shout, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" What began in a little wooden manger was coming to an end on an old wooden cross. Do you remember that? How could we ever forget his death? And do you remember his words as he had his hands stretched out on the cross? He said, "It is finished. It's over. It's done." Folks, how could you forget those words and what he did for you and me on the cross? How could you forget his life? How could you forget his death? And how could you forget the sacrifice that he made? Folks, you and I, and Ralph was talking about this a few minutes ago, you and I have been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. How could we ever forget his sacrifice, his life's blood? How could we ever forget the one who never forgot us, and he said, "I never will forget you, I'll never leave you, and I'll never forsake you"? Folks, his name is Jesus. You can't forget him. You can't block him out of your memory. You can just never, once you come to know Jesus, do without him. He's your everything. But folks, listen, you and I forget Jesus. Let's be honest. We sometimes forget him. We forget to talk to him in prayer. We forget to read his word so he can talk to us through his word. We forget to worship him in spirit and in truth. And you know the reason we forget Jesus? Because there's so many things going on around us to attract our attention and to get our focus off Jesus. But this morning, we're going to take the cloth off the table in a few minutes. And we're going to gather around the Lord's table together. And you know what we're going to do? We're going to take all the distractions of the world and we're going to remove them from this place. And we're going to come this morning and we're going to take that bread and we're going to take that cup and we're going to remember this morning. We're going to remember his life, and we're going to remember his death, and we're going to remember his sacrifice for us. Because, folks, these are things that you and I should never, ever forget. Amen. His name is Jesus. And there are a lot of things, as I get older, I forget. And every day I forget more and more and more. But there's one thing that I could never, ever, ever forget. And that's my Lord and my Savior, Jesus Christ, and what He did for me and what He means to me. As we gather around the table this morning, folks, remember why we're here, to do this in remembrance of Jesus Christ. You know, the Bible says in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, I didn't read all that, but starting in verse number 23, it says, "For I have received of the Lord that which I also delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he brake it and said, Take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me. And in the same manner took the cup, and after when he had supped, saying, This cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do ye as often as ye drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as ye eat this bread and drink this cup, ye do show the Lord's death till he comes." And every time I read that, I want to say, "Even so, Lord Jesus, come quickly, quickly." Wherefore, listen, wherefore, whosoever shall eat of this bread and drink of this cup of the Lord unworthily shall be guilty of the body and the blood of the Lord. But let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of that bread and drink of that cup. It's God's will that those who have been washed in the blood and belong to His church, whose names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life, partake of this Lord's Supper together. But He wants us to do it in a worthy way. Now, folks, none of us are perfect. The only way we can approach the Lord's Supper table in a worthy way is for God to look upon us and see us through the blood of His precious Son, Jesus. But He wants us to come as clean as we could possibly come. And that means that we examine ourselves. And let the Holy Spirit of God be a mirror held up before us so we can see ourselves as God sees us this morning. And we can get rid of those things that are in our life that ought not to be in our life. To confess those sins so that we can approach the Lord's Supper table in a worthy, and again, worthy way. A way that is pleasing to God. Father, help us this morning as your church, as your people who are called by your name, who have been washed in the blood of your Son. Help us this morning to examine our hearts and examine our lives and approach the Lord's Supper table today in a worthy way. Father, reveal to us those things that are in our life that ought not to be in our life. Father, reveal to us our sins today so that we might confess our sins and claim the promise that if we confess our sins to you, you'll forgive us of all of our sins. And you'll wash us and make us as white as snow. Right now, with every head bowed and every eye closed, would you just pray? Would you let God examine you wholly and truthfully and completely? And would you confess those things that you need to confess to God this morning? Then after you confess your sins, pray a prayer of praise to God and just thank Him today for your salvation. Thank Him today that He's still forgiving you of your sins, throwing them out in the deepest parts of the ocean, never calling them to mind. So even this morning, we can approach the Lord's Supper table in a way that's pleasing to Him. Father, right now, help us to examine ourselves so we might be found worthy in Your sight. Thank You for this table that's been prepared by our deacons this morning. Father, thank You for the significance of the bread and the cup that we're going to. In Matthew chapter 26, starting in verse number 26. And as they were eating, Jesus took bread and blessed it and broke it, gave thanks, gave it to His disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is My body." And He took the cup and gave thanks and gave it to them, saying, "Drink ye all of it. For this is My blood of the New Testament, which is shed for many for the remission of sin. But I say unto you, I will not drink henceforth of this fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new with you in My Father's kingdom." When they had sung a hymn, they went out into the Mount of Olives.
Thank you. we come to thee this morning, dear Lord, we just thank thee that you sent your son, that he died on the cross, and that through his blood that we can have eternal life, dear Lord. Father, we thank thee that this day that we can drink this wine in remembrance of what he did for us, dear Lord, and that the only thing we have to do is have faith and believe in him, and we can have eternal life, dear Lord. Father, we ask that you will be with the rest of this service, that you especially be with our service tonight, dear Lord, and all the churches that will be attending. Father, we ask that you will be with our pastor and his wife through this time as they're having these health problems, dear Lord, that you would bless them and let them know that we're praying for them daily, dear Lord. Father, we just love you and thank thee for giving us eternal life. In thy name we pray. Amen.
And he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them and said, "Drink ye all of it." Thank you for this morning. Father, it's always a special time when we gather around the Lord's Supper table together as the family of the Lord Jesus Christ. I pray we've done it in a way that is worthy of you today. And in all that we've done, we've remembered your life, your death, and your sacrifice. Father, now as we go into this time of invitation, the Lord's Supper is a message all by itself. And I just pray that through the bread and the cup today, you've spoken to the hearts and the lives of the people that are gathered in this place. Father, if there's one here today that's lost without you, I pray today be the day that they'd be saved. Pray for those who need to come, put their life in this church. This is where you want them to worship or serve. I pray for those who just need to come and pray today. Maybe in a spirit of rededication, commitment, maybe just to come today and say, "Father, I need your help. I need your strength. I need your presence." Maybe just to come and say, "Jesus, just want to say thank you." Father, use this time of invitation. In Jesus' name we pray.